In this unit, the learning objectives are to discuss the relationship between freight cost and the price of transported products, and to evaluate the customs procedure in the import and export of goods. So the first unit is to discuss the relationship between freight cost to the price of transported goods. So in the maritime transport costs are basically it is divided into multiple aspects. So first thing is the ports. So the charges that the companies which are transporting the goods that they have to pay. So in ports, there is infra and superstructure, there is port productivity, the port tariffs, and the transport costs also relate to the trade flows, such as trade imbalances. So for example, one country is imposing a lot of import duties, while the other country is not reciprocating. Then there is a structure of maritime industry, which basically relates to the competition. So there may be competing transport service providers. So one may be offering a lower price and a slightly delayed transport, whereas the other may be offering a higher price and a quick mode of transport. So these aspects, they impact the maritime transport costs. So then there is the position within the global shipping network. So the connectivity, the centrality, and the distance, like as we have studied in the previous session, the distance is often impacts the cost of the transport. So the air transport is the costliest, whereas the ship, the ocean transport is the weakest. I mean, it is the least cost. Then there are the ship operating costs, which relates to the crewing, the bunker registration, and then there is the facilitation charges, basically the customs duties, the transport facilitation, the warehousing, the storage charges. So all these charges, they are added to the maritime transport costs. So based on all these charges, company has to determine the most appropriate mode of transport. So there are several factors which impact the freight costs and price of transported goods. So the first is the trade and transport facilitation. So reducing waiting times in seaports for ships and the cargo has a direct bearing on trade costs. So basically, the longer the goods stay on the port, the cost becomes higher, that you have to pay the handling charges, you have to pay this for the storage charges. So these are the charges that are there. And from a shipper's perspective, lower costs associated with the holding of inventory, whereas waiting times also imply the costs to the carrier, which will ultimately have to be passed on to the client via freight charges. So basically, reduced waiting times leads to a more cost-effective mode of transport. So there's a research which estimated that a 10% reduction of the time in the custom implies a reduction in maritime freight of about 0.5%. So that again has an impact on the prices to the end consumer. Then we have the factors of the ship operating costs. So the technological advances have contributed greatly towards lowering the ship operating costs. For example, where previously labor was used for moving the goods from one place to another, now it can be done by machines such as cranes, and within the port you have rails or other modes of moving the goods. And there is the factor of improved fuel efficiency, economies of scale, and automation. So this was the one I was talking about. They have all helped to reduce the costs as well as the impact on the environment. So, however, the drive to invest in lower operating costs may have some negative repercussion on freight rates. So what does this mean? It means that as carriers invest in larger and more energy efficient vehicles, they also contribute to further oversupply of capacity, which again leads to reduction of rates. So while the individual carrier may benefit from cost savings due to oversupply, it can lose business. I mean, there will be many suppliers and but very less buyers. So basically, the suppliers will have to lower their prices. So while the operating costs of the shipping are decreasing, the total costs have declined relatively less. This is due to the reason that total cost of the carrier also involves investing in new assets. Secondly, the transportation companies, or basically the port operators, they have to invest heavily in infrastructure to generate this cost savings. But similarly, so larger ships also require ports and port cities to invest in additional capacities for storage. So these lead to additional costs. Like more infrastructure development, it always leads to a negative impact on the environment. So this impacts the local communities and the surrounding environment. So the lower operating costs as compared to higher fixed cost will also lead to a more volatile freight rate. So due to the automation and other aspects, the operating costs are low, but the companies have to incur high fixed costs. Like for port operations, there will be high fixed costs such as paying tariffs to the government, the lease, and then paying salaries. So all those comes under fixed costs. So the second factor which impacts the freight costs and price of transported goods is the distance and a country's position within shipping network. So a country with well-established ports and well-connected shipping networks stands to benefit the most when it comes to lowering the cost of transportation. So shipping goods over long distance requires more time and capital costs and fuel, which is the operating cost. Therefore, trading partners which are located very far away, they are faced with higher freight costs. However, using the example of shipping costs to Baltimore, the geographic distance cannot alone explain price difference in freight rates. So in the figure, it shows that the geographic distance does not contribute only due to the freight rate. So here we see that there is no relationship between distance and maritime transport cost. So again, this can be an exception or it can be applicable to certain areas, but overall there is a general acceptance that choosing an appropriate mode of transport that determines how the company is able to save costs. Now we go to the factor of competition and market regulation. So price setting in transport and logistics market is a very, like, it's a low margin business and the competition is high. So any restrictions in free competition and a collusion between two companies, it can result in monopolies. So basically what happens that if one company invests greatly and another player, if it comes and if it is not able to invest that much, so it may collude with the larger provider, whereas both of them can decide to fix on it. So that again leads to the, I mean, dictating of price by these companies. Then there are different strategies of shipping lines. So some of them may carry specific type of cargo, for example, container cargo. Others may carry non-container cargo. So the availability of these ships is also a factor which leads to differential in price of transported goods. Then strategic alliances between the port and the shipping industry, it influences the maritime network structure to a great extent. And it also leads to optimization of prices, so that the industry also checks that there is no monopoly of one or two players in the shipping market. Then the price of the transported goods is dependent on the value, volume, and type of product shipped. So the value of the product is also very crucial towards the price the company is willing to pay. For example, if it is a very highly sensitive cargo, then the company might be willing to pay more. Whereas if it is a general good such as toys or some daily use items such as home furnishing items, so that is not very sensitive, that is like a general cargo. So the company may not be willing to pay more, and they might also be willing to accept some late, it may not be an expedited delivery. So they may be willing to pay less for that. So the unit value, the basic learning is that the unit value is inversely related to elasticity of demand for transport. So the higher the demand for transport, and that is the shippers are willing to pay higher or even premium rates. So there is a study by Billings, Meyer and Sanchez which shows that a 10% rise in the value of commodity increases the transport cost by around 7.6%. So again, if the value of the commodity is higher, the company is willing to pay higher shipping costs for it. Then we have the containerized cargo. So they have some standard units in which it can be transported. So again, refrigerated cargo, they have certain restrictions. So they need to the cargo of these type needs to be taken extra care. So therefore, the shipper is willing to pay extra rates for this. So the best way the company can optimize on cost is by generating economies of scale. So the first thing is the internal economies of scale, which reflect the decrease in transport costs per ton as the size of individual shipment increases. Second is the system external economies of scale, which reflects the decrease in cost as the volume increases. So basically, the company needs to decide its optimum level, like where it achieves this economy of scale. So the economies of scale are also realized outside a company as a result of its location, and occur when trade between two countries. So, or if there is a effective, I mean, efficient connectivity between the two countries. For example, in the Eurozone, you can transport goods by through road, through rail. Then it becomes you have a choice of transport or through air. So that also reduces your cost of transport. So if you see this figure here, it explains the transport costs and economies of scale. So as the volumes go high, your costs go low. So your volumes are on x-axis and your cost is on y-axis. So these things are, this is like this figure is plotted over a period of 5 years. So you see that higher volumes, they lead to decreased cost of transported goods. Then another factor which influences the price of transported goods, basically amount which the shipper pays, is the port infrastructure. So a port infrastructure is generally maintained by government or by large companies. So but the port infrastructure is created with the objective of connecting the different modes of transport. Like, and the most efficient port infrastructure is where we have connectivity with roads, we have connectivity with rail, we have connectivity with flight mode, I mean through air freight. So an efficient port infrastructure will make use of all these other infrastructure. So basically the productivity with related to ports are basically physical, which means the physical infrastructure, the level of automation, and how much the operating costs are reduced. Then the institution, I mean whether the company is making money, the company which is operating the ports are making money, whether they are able to expand, whether they are able to carry out their duties, I mean whether they are able to provide proper services such as labor charges, handling fees, like online submission of forms for like import export. So those factors are important for a port infrastructure. Then the price of transported goods are also influenced by trade flow and imbalances. So the volume and the type of cargo has a direct impact on the cost of the carrier's cost. So the volume of cargo, as you saw, it is important to generate economies of scale, and also the extent to which the costs incurred by the carrier are passed to the client depends on the market conditions. So when a trade in case of a negative trade balance, the a country's imports exceeds its exports, and the lower the freight rates and greater the imbalance. So it means that if you have more imports, then the company may not be willing, the company may be forced to put a levy so that there is some balance restored between imports and exports. So this figure we see like what are the international transport costs, the freight costs as value of imports. So this is a 10-year average, and this is done across different countries. If you see, it is like Africa, Oceania, developing country, Asia, America, transition economy, developed economies. So the main learning from this is that for all the transport costs has been reducing significantly for basic, especially for if you see. The in fact it, you see for all it has drastically reduced for countries like America, for developed nations, for developed economies it has reduced, for developing economies if you see Asia it has remained mostly like similar, it has not decreased significantly, But then there is a different impact. So the main reason is that the developed economies, they have integrated their different modes of transport and the infrastructure. So they have well connected roads, they have well connected rails, then they have air freight, flight routes where air cargo can be taken from one location to another, and then they have well developed ports. So that is the main factor which contributes to the price of transported goods. Next, we go to evaluation of customs procedures in the import and export of goods. So what are the import customs procedures in UK? So these are like the legal requirements. So some of the legal, which is a bit technical, so I will just go through it. When importing goods into UK, the exporters must complete an intra-stat declaration. So exporter means, suppose if a company is exporting from China to UK, so the shipper from China, they have to sign an intra-stat declaration. And this declaration is required when the value of goods that are subject to custom duty exceeds 6,000 GBP. So if you regularly import duty goods in which duty is applicable, you can save time by completing and registering a general valuation statement. So there is another option. The European Union has set up a system of import control, which is called the ICS, which aims to secure the flow of goods at the time of entry into the customs territory of EU. So EU is a customs union, so the information is available to all the member countries. So this system is called e-customs, is effective since January, and then since then the operators are required to pass an entry summary declaration prior to introduction of goods, and then it simplifies the procedures basically, for example by computerization and centralizing transactions. So if a good is in transit from UK through France to Italy, so it does not have to enter the fresh details again. It will be available across the customs of those countries. Then there are specific import procedures such as CFSP, which is a customs freight simplified procedure. So this is designed to simplify customs procedures for clearing imported goods at the border or upon removal from a free zone. So few of the goods, they may require import licenses. So such as these are like firearms and explosives, nuclear materials, controlled drugs, and certain military equipment. So these require import licenses. And products that are imported temporarily, they are generally admitted without payment of duties and taxes. So basically there are certain tariffs which are there, which is imposed by UK. There is the average customs duty excluding the agricultural products, so these are the general rate. Then products which have a higher customs tariff, they include textile, clothing items, and certain food processing industry sectors, they have duty as high as 17.3%, and they are very much protective measures are taken by UK so as to protect the local industries. So any imports, they attract higher customs tariffs. So again, there are preferential rates with the trading partners, like these are granted to imports from countries with which the European Union has signed trade agreement. So with UK they have signed, but after Brexit they have to renegotiate again. And the duties are calculated based on the goods in accordance with the common customs tariff, and payment can be in cash or through a bank account transfer. So export procedures. So within the UK, there is free movements of goods. Within the EU, including the UK. But if the goods have to go out of the European Union, customs clearance is necessary. So the goods are placed for a period of 20 days maximum in warehouses or custom clearance areas. Where if it has to be transported through ships, 45 days it has the max. That is the maximum period in which they are placed for customs clearance. And the customs form, they must include information on the origin of goods, the tariffs, valuation of the goods, the destination. These aspects should be covered. Then what is the mode of transportation that is generally preferred by exporters from UK? So 97% of the British external trade is handled by sea transport. So that is about 500 million tons a year. So like we discussed in earlier chapters, sea transport is the least cost option for companies to transport goods. So as you see, this is also utilized by British exporters. Then some of the major ports are like London, Aberdeen, Peel ports, England, Scotland, Wales. There are more than 80 ports as member in the British ports as well. It's like just general knowledge. And the domestic air service, like air transport, is provided by KLM, EasyJet, and British Airways. Although EasyJet and KLM are most cheaper options. And again, UK is a powerful market of European road transport. So it has a very well-organized road transport, so which helps in reducing the cost of transported goods. So here we see like the maximum imports and exports of UK is there, where it goes and where it comes from. Same figure, it is explained over here. Like maximum UK imports is from Germany, then China, then United States. Then exports maximum, it goes to United States and Germany, France. So mostly if you see, it is like Germany, France are there, Netherlands, and so most of it is EU countries. Whereas the imports are mostly from, again, from EU countries. So this is what we have till for today's session. It was a short session. Hello. Anybody has any questions, you can ask me. Questions are there, you can ask me.